Hello students, this is Aman Jain, Assistant Professor, Department of Civil Engineering, Sir Padampath Singhania University. This is the second video lecture of subject called CE458 Payment Design. So today's lecture is on, will be focused on factors affecting payment design. So let's begin it with this lecture. Before beginning with this lecture, let's have a quick recap of the lecture 1, that what we learned in the lecture 1 from the definition to payment and to the its failure criteria, because it is very much important to learn about the payment failure criteria, that in which conditions the payment fails. So it is very much important to know the failure criteria. So let's have a quick recap of those failure the definition of the payment and the failure criteria and everything about types of payment. Then ultimately we will have a recap of failure criteria, and then we will study these factors affecting the design of payment. So this was the overview, that highway payment is a structure consisting of superimposed layer of processed material above the natural soil subgrade, whose primary function is to distribute the applied vehicle load to the subgrade. The payment structure should also be able to provide a surface acceptable for riding quality, adequate skid resistance, favorable light reflecting characteristics, and low noise pollution. So it is a definition of payment, that what payment is and what is the function of payment. Two types of payments are generally recognized as serving this purpose, namely flexible payments and rigid payments. This presentation gives an overview of payment types, layers, and their functions and payment failures. So this was the first presentation in which we studied about payment types, layers, their functions, and payment failures. So improper design of payments leads to early failure of payments, affecting the riding quality. So this was your definition and types of payment, and an ideal payment requirement, which should be sufficient thick to distribute the wheel load stresses to a safe value on the soil subgrade, structurally strong, adequate coefficient of friction, smooth surface to provide comfort to road users, produce least noise from the vehicles, and should be of dust proof surface, impervious surface, so that the subgrade soil is well protected from the water, long design life, and low maintenance cost. So these were the types of payment, flexible and rigid. The flexible payments, wheel loads are transferred grain to grain contact of aggregate through granular surface, and the flexible payments are having less flexural strength, and they act like a flexible sheet, just like example bituminous road. On the contrary, the rigid payments, the wheel load has transferred to soil subgrade by flexural strength of the payment, and the payment acts like a rigid plate. Okay, the example of the rigid payment was a cement concrete load. In addition to those, there are some composite payments are also available. A thin layer of flexible payment over a rigid payment is an ideal payment, which has most desirable characteristics, but such payments are rarely used in new construction because of high cost and complex analysis required. So this was the load transfer in granular structure, where this is the wheel, this is a wheel load, and this is a granular structure. This is the contact of the grain, and this is a grain to grain transfer of the loads. So this is a typical cross section. This was a typical cross section of flexible payment. This is surface course, binder course, dash course, sub base course, compacted subgrade, and this was the natural subgrade. And this is the typical thickness of the layers which we are providing. That is, compacted subgrade should be start from 150 mm to 300 mm. Sub-base core should be at 100 to 300 mm. Base core should be 100 to 300 mm. Again, final core should be 50 to 100 mm. And surface core should be in between 25 to 50 mm. Then there are few codes. There was a prime code between binder and base cores. We are applying, tape code is applied between surface and binder cores, and seal code is applied on the bearing cores, that is the top surface. There are three types of flexible payments: conventional layered flexible payment, full depth asphalt payment, and contained rock asphalt, which is also known as CRAM. This was base course. We studied about subgrade, rigid, and various layers. So this is the rigid pavement. This is a typical cross section of rigid pavement. Rigid pavement have sufficient flexural strength to transmit the wheel load stresses to a wider area below. Generally, this pavement has two layers only. Upon the natural soil subgrade, that is the base or subbase course, and poured cement concrete. And their thickness is around 100 to 300 mm and 150 to 300 mm respectively. So this was rigid pavement, and this is how in rigid pavement the load is distributed. This is how the load is distributed, and this is the action is known as the slab action, and the pavement behaves like an elastic plate. This is the elastic plate, and this is the viscous foundation on which this elastic plate is resting. So these are the types of rigid pavements. Rigid pavements are of four types: jointed plain concrete pavement, JPCP, jointed reinforced concrete pavement, JRCP, continuous reinforced concrete pavement, CRCP, pre-stressed concrete pavement, PCP. And the summary was payments from the basic supporting structure in highway, a payment form the basic supporting structure in highway transportation. Each layer of payment has a multitude functions to perform, which has to be duly considered during the design process. Different types of payments can be adapted depending upon the traffic requirements, which we have discussed before, their types and their subtypes. Improper design of payments leads to early failure of the payments, affecting the riding quality also. So let's have a look on the failure criteria. Failure of flexible payments. The major flexible payment failure are due to fatigue cracking, rutting, and thermal cracking. The fatigue cracking of flexible pavement is due to the horizontal tensile strain at the bottom of the asphaltic concrete. Failure criteria relates allowable number of road repetitions to tensile strain, and this relation can be determined in the laboratory fatigue test on asphaltic concrete specimen. Rutting occurs only on flexible pavement. So this has to be remembered, that rutting only occurs in flexible pavements, as indicated by permanent deformation or rut depth along the wheel load depth. Two design methods have been used to control rutting. So whenever we have to control the rutting, there are two design methods. One, to limit the vertical compressive strength and on the top of the subgrade, and other, to limit rutting to a tolerable amount, 12 mm normally. So there are two methods by which the rutting can be eliminated, and the two methods are, the first one is to limit the vertical compressive strain at the top of the subgrade, and the second one is to limit rutting up to 12 mm, and that is a tolerable amount. Thermal cracking includes both low temperature cracking and thermal fatigue cracking. So this is due to the thermal, due to the temperature differential which occurs bottom of the pavement and top of the pavement both. So this is the failure criteria of rigid payments. Traditionally, fatigue cracking has been considered as the major or only criteria for rigid payment design. The allowable number of load repetitions to cause fatigue cracking depends on the stress ratio between flexural tensile stress and concrete modulus of rupture. Of late, pumping is identified as an important failure criteria. What is pumping? Let's look at the definition of pumping. Pumping is the ejection of soil slurry through the joints and the cracks of the cement concrete pavement caused during the downward movement of slab under the heavy beam loads. So as I said that rigid pavements behave like a slab, and when they get cracked, and when they get cracked and heavy loads due to the wheel loads occur on the highway, and due to their downward movement, the soil slurry comes out on the roads, on the road or the pavement surface. That failure criteria is known as pumping. So after pumping, other major types of distress in rigid pavements includes faulting, spalling and deterioration. These criteria you might have studied in concrete technology, that what is spalling, what is deterioration and what is faulting. So this was the module 1. Let's now start the factors which affects the affecting the pavement design. So in the previous lecture we have gone through that there are many factors that affect the pavement design, which can be classified into 4 categories. The first of all is the traffic and loading. The second one is structure models. The third one is material characterization, and the fourth thing is environment. Let's have a look at the first one, traffic and loading. First, traffic is the most important factor of the pavement design. So this is the only factor for which we are designing the highways, the traffic. And the key factors includes the contact pressure, wheel load, axle configuration, moving loads and load repetitions. So these are the contact pressure first, second is the wheel load, third is axle configuration, third, and then fourth is moving loads, fifth loads and load repetition. So everything is taken into account, the wheel load and when it is moving or it is stationary, and the load and their load repetitions. So what is the contact pressure? Contact pressure is the tire pressure is an important factor as it determines the contact area and the contact pressure between the wheel and the pavement surface. Even though the shape of the contact is slight bit elliptical, but for the sake of the simplicity, we always take the it is circular. What is wheel load? Wheel load, the next important factor is the wheel load, which determines the depth of pavement and required to ensure the subgrade that the subgrade soil is not failed. Wheel configuration affects the strain distribution and deflection within a pavement. Many commercial vehicles have dual rear wheel assemblies. So whenever if you are watching the buses or trucks, there are there are multi-axled vehicles, so that they can affect they can carry more load in a small area or area of the pavement. So many commercial vehicles have dual rear wheels, which ensure that the contact pressure is within the limits. Then it comes to the normal practice is to convert dual wheel into an equivalent ESWL, that is known as equivalent single wheel load, so that the analysis is made simpler. And then it comes the axle configuration. The load carrying capacity of the commercial vehicle is further enhanced by their introduction of multiple axles. So multiple axles are when we'll go to design part, we will see that how many axled vehicles and for what we are for what we will design the payment. There are few codes which are designed by IRC, Indian Road Congress. They tell very many things in detail about the axle configuration of the vehicles, the length of vehicles, the tire pressure. There are many things which will come further in the slides. What is the moving loads? The damage to the pavement is much higher if the vehicle is moving at creep speed. There is a creep speed which is very slow. Many studies show that when the speed is increased from 2 km per hour to 24 km per hour, the stress and deflection is reduced by 40%. So this is the factor to be, this is an important factor which is to be keep in mind while designing the highway. Repetition of loads, the influence of the traffic on pavement not only depend upon the magnitude of the wheel load, but also on the frequency of the load applications. Each load application causes some deformation, and the total deformation is summation of all these. So we are taking all the loads into account, and then we are finally adding them up. Although the pavement deformation due to single axle load is very small, the cumulative effect of number of load repetition is significant. So one should not say that it is very small, but he has to do analysis of repetitive loads, and the sum of that comes to a significant factor. Therefore, the modern design is based on the total number of standard axle load that is usually taken as 80 kN of single axle. So, the second thing is structural models. The structural models are various analysis approaches to determine the pavement responses. How pavement is responding to a particular load, this is given by a particular model. And the responses are in the form of stresses, strains, and deflections at various location in a pavement due to the application of wheel load. The next thing is the most common structural models are layered elastic model, and the second model is viscoelastic model. So there are two models. Layered elastic model. What is layered elastic model? A layered elastic model can compute stresses, strains, and deflection at any point in pavement structure resulting from the application of surface load. Layered elastic models assumes that each pavement structure layer is homogeneous, isotropic, and linearly elastic. In other words, the material properties are same at every point in a given layer, and the layer will be rebound to its original shape once the load is removed. The layered elastic approach works with relatively simple mathematical models that relates stress, strain, and deformation with wheel loading and material properties like modulus of elasticity and Poisson's ratio. Material characterization. The third thing is the material characterization. The folding material properties are important for both flexible and rigid pavements. So many of the natural materials are same in our rigid or flexible pavement as well. When pavements are considered as linear elastic, the elastic moduli are Poisson's ratio of subgrade and each component layer must be specified. If the elastic modulus of a material varies with the time and loading, then the resilient modulus, the second important thing is the resilient modulus, which is elastic modulus under repetitive load, loads must be selected in accordance with the load duration corresponding to the vehicle speed. When a material is considered non-linear elastic, the constitutive equation relating the resilient modulus to the state of stress must be provided. However, many of these material properties are used in viscoelastic models, but which are very complex and in the development stage. So, which will be discussed in the further designing process as and when they are required. Last, the final thing is environmental factors. Environmental factors affect the performance of the pavement materials and cause various damages to the cause various damages like it is due to temperature and due to precipitation. There are two major factors, which is the first one is the temperature and the second one is precipitation. The temperature temperature affects the asphalt pavements in different form from the that of the concrete pavements. Temperature affects the resilient modulus of asphalt layers while it induces curling of concrete slab in the rigid pavement. So one has to see that the temperature affects differently on the both pavements. It affects the resilient modulus of the asphalt layers, whereas it induces the curling of concrete slab in rigid pavements. So due to difference in the temperature at the top and bottom of the slab, temperature stresses or friction stresses are developed. While in flexible pavement, dynamic modulus of asphaltic concrete varies with the temperature. Frost heave causes differential settlements and pavement roughness. Most detrimental effect of the frost penetration occurs during the spring breakup period when the ice melts and subgrade is in a saturated condition. So this problem generally occurs in the hilly areas where there is a snowfall. That is of course not a problem. And the precipitation from rain and snow affects the quantity of surface water infiltration into the subgrade and depth of groundwater table. Poor drainage may bring lack of shear strength, pumping, and loss of support. So the environmental factors can be summarized in this way, that only precipitation and your temperature affect it, and they both are the major factors. Thank you.